46 years ago, two of the greatest Yankees in history received the call to the Hall. It was announced that Mickey Mantle and Whitey Ford were the only two players in the Hall of Fame's class of 1974. Mantle received over 88% of the vote in his first year of eligibility, and Whitey made it in his second year, being named on almost 78% of the ballots. But checking out the top candidates for the class of 2020, right now there are three above the threshold to get in. That's with 156 of the estimated 412 ballots that are made public right now. Derek Jeter polling at 100%. Larry Walker has 85%. Curt Schilling at 80.1%. Just below the threshold, Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens. So let's talk, Jack, big picture right now, because history tells us that a lot changes on some of those numbers in the last week of the voting. A lot of the ballots are not made public.
Right, and Yankee fans are wondering, can Jeter follow Mariano Rivera into immortality, which he will? Can he follow him unanimously? That's the big question. I have my doubts that he's going to get 100%. I can't tell you why someone wouldn't vote for Derek Jeter. I think he absolutely deserves the first ballot vote. You look at the numbers that he put up in his career, 35 in the area of 3,500 hits, the World Series titles, the ability to perform in the postseason, a few gold gloves, doing it all in New York. But I just have a feeling that someone is not going to check that box near Jeter, and that he's not going to be what Mariano was.
Yeah, that's the only intriguing part of Derek Jeter, right? What's the percentage going to look like? Because when you have a resume like that, you're going to be a first ballot Hall of Famer. So we'll see what the numbers come back. Larry Walker's the guy for me, and everybody's starting to make some cases for Larry Walker. And when you listen to the numbers and how they rank, you know, all time, it's pretty compelling. And, you know, playing against this guy, a great right fielder who had a cannon of an arm, was a great base runner, could steal bases, and had plenty of power and plenty of slugging percentage. So, the knock has always been Coors Field. The numbers away from Coors Field are just as impressive. So, his last year on the ballot, Jack, the question is, does Larry Walker sneak in?
It's going to be close, and I'm glad you mentioned those numbers away from Coors Field. He has an 865 road OPS in his career. That's better than George Brett, Ken Griffey Jr., Reggie Jackson, and Willie Stargell. There's the career by stadium right there. Played 70% of his games at Coors Field. I'm going to throw some more numbers at you. Only six players can match his average, his on-base percentage, and his slugging. Want to hear those names? Greenberg, Gehrig, Fox, Ted Williams, Rogers Hornsby, and a guy by the name of Babe Ruth. Put Larry Walker in the Hall of Fame, for crying out loud.
I think some of the numbers you mentioned, and I think analytics over the last, let's say, 5 years have certainly helped other candidates. Jack, how much of that do you weigh now? Where maybe 6 years ago you liked Larry Walker, but now you love him because of some of the new numbers.
I've consistently voted for Larry Walker. I can't say for certain that in all 10 years I've voted for him, but I'm going to say for 8 or 9 of those years I have voted for him. Because when I've talked to people about him, Bob, he always struck me as a complete player. We're throwing these numbers out here, but he was also a gifted defensive player. He was a terrific base runner. I felt like he covered all of those games. But in answer to your question, yes, analytics is still a big part of it. You weren't looking at WAR 20 years ago when you had a Hall of Fame ballot. Now, someone like Jay Jaffe, who does a great job with Hall of Fame research, they'll give you what the standard WAR is for each position, so that has to factor into what you're doing.
We just showed your ballot, and you had Curt Schilling checked off on your ballot. Is he going to make it?
I think he's going to fall a little bit short. I didn't even realize that was my ballot as I looked at that graphic. I think Schilling eventually gets in, Flash, but if you look at the numbers as he is tracking right now, he's at about 80%, and historically, the ballots that come out early that are made public, the ballots that succeed that, the numbers are going to go down a little bit. They're going to go down a little bit for Bonds and Clemens. They're going to go down a little bit for Schilling. That's why Walker is so dicey, because he's at about 85% right now at the public ballots. But you look at those numbers, when I look at the postseason for Schilling, what he did for those three teams that he helped win World Series champions, some people say the 216 wins are a little light. I don't think so. I think he's a definite Hall of Famer.
But how much does the other factor come in? He's such a polarizing figure, not beloved in the game, not beloved for some of the stuff he did off the field after he left the game. It's a tough call. And to Jack's point, we've seen some of these players, when the public ballot comes out, or when the all of them come out, they drop 10 or 11 points from where we sit today.
Yeah, so that would tell us that Curt Schilling's probably in trouble. But I am so glad that I'm not Jack Curry and I don't have a vote, because the personality part would absolutely come in for me. And, you know, Curt Schilling was a tough guy to compete against when you stepped in the box, but also how he would talk in between starts and kind of get things going. That's why players don't get to vote for these things, because the personality part would definitely be a huge factor.
It impacts you and you think about it, but I voted on Curt Schilling as a pitcher. I did not vote for him for his opinions. This is a guy who there was a tweet or something about lynching journalists and about a t-shirt or something, and he was all for it. So if I was judging him based on that, he would never get my vote. But for this situation, even though when you get the Hall of Fame ballot, they talk about bringing integrity and character into it, I still gave Schilling my vote.
And of course, that factors into Barry Bonds, Roger Clemens, the things that they have done.
Again, that impacts the game, Bob. Schilling running his mouth, that didn't win him any games, even though you said he might have tried to get into some guys' heads. I think with Bonds and Clemens, I don't vote for them because I think they cheated the game. I think the suspicion about steroid that is so much about them, that if you are that overt in cheating, I think that there's a penalty or a punishment that you have to pay for that. That's why I don't vote for them.
It is interesting, though, when the voting roles have sort of changed. It's gotten a little younger. Some writers were kicked out. I wouldn't say kicked out. They were eliminated several years back, that it's certainly swung a little bit more in their favor.
It definitely has, and the numbers are improving slightly every year when the voters get a little bit younger. But, you know, we're going through this whole cheating scandal, and you wonder if time's going to heal some of those wounds as well. It seems like it has with some of these steroid users, that their numbers are getting better, and you wonder if they get to year 10 on the ballot, will people feel compelled to vote them in?